Welcome to the first of several examples of finding the zeros of a polynomial function. There are two main ideas we need to be aware of to help us find the zeros or roots of a polynomial function. First, if we're allowed to graph the polynomial function, then the real zeros of the function will be the x-intercepts of the graph. So while even though all of the real zeros will show as x-intercepts, if they're real and rational, we can use these to help us find the zeros and also to write the function in factored form. If we're not allowed to use the graph to help us find the zeros of the function, then we'll have to use the rational zeros theorem, which says if a polynomial function has real rational zeros, they will be a ratio of the factors of the constant term to the factors of the leading coefficient. So what that means is, if we look at this example here, if this function does have real rational zeros, it would have to be a ratio of the factors of 6 to the factors of positive 2. Well, the factors of 6, or the numbers that divide evenly into 6, would be plus or minus 1, plus or minus 2, plus or minus 3, and plus or minus 6. And the factors of 2 would be plus or minus 1, and plus or minus 2. So the ratio of these factors would give us possible rational zeros of the given polynomial. So let's go ahead and list these. If we have a denominator of plus or minus 1, it's not going to affect the factors of the numerator. So we'd have factors of plus or minus 1, plus or minus 2, plus or minus 3, and plus or minus 6. But now if we use a denominator of 2 from these factors here, notice how we'd have plus or minus 1 over 2, that's plus or minus 1 half. Plus or minus 2 over 2, that's plus or minus 1, which we already have. Plus or minus 3 halves. And then we'd have plus or minus 6 over 2, which is plus or minus 3, which we already have. So the rational zeros of this function must come from this list. So from here, we'd have to use trial and error to see which of these would make the function equal to 0. So if we are allowed to use a graph, it's extremely helpful. For this first basic example, we'll look at it both ways. We'll find the zeros using the graph, and then we'll also find the zeros using the rational root theorem, just so you can see the difference. So if we graph this function, we're looking for the x-intercepts. Notice how this function crosses the x-axis at negative 3, positive 1, and positive 5, which are the zeros of this function. So you can see this graph was extremely helpful in this case. It gave us all of the zeros. Now we should make the connection that if these are the zeros, this would help us write this function in factored form. Our function f of x would have to have a factor of x plus 3 from the 0 of negative 3. It would have to have a factor of x minus 1 from the 0 of positive 1. And would also have to have a factor of x minus 5 from the 0 of positive 5. Again, graphically, we found the zeros very easily because they were all real and rational. Now, assuming we could not look at the graph, we would have to use the rational root theorem to find these zeros. So we'd have to first start with a list of possible rational zeros, which again would be the factors of the constant term, in this case 15, over the factors of the leading coefficient, which in this case is just 1. So the factors of 15 would be plus or minus 1, plus or minus 3, plus or minus 5, and plus or minus 15. Of course, the factors of 1, just plus or minus 1. We form our ratio here. Having a denominator of plus or minus 1 is not going to affect our possible rational zeros from the factors of 15. So the possible rational zeros would have to be plus or minus 1, plus or minus 3, plus or minus 5, and plus or minus 15. So from here, we have two ways to determine which of these would be the rational zeros. We can sub them into the function and see which make the function equal to 0, or we can use these values to perform synthetic division and see which would give a remainder of 0. So let's use synthetic division, and let's start with a possible 0 of, let's say, negative 1. So we'd perform synthetic division. We'd have negative 1 here in this little box, and then we list the coefficients of the polynomial. So we have 1, negative 3, negative 13, and positive 15. And now we're hoping that the remainder is 0. Again, this is assuming we didn't already find the zeros graphically. So we bring the 1 down, multiply by negative 1, that's negative 1, add, multiply by negative 1 again, that's positive 4, add, multiply by negative 1 again, that's positive 9, add, it's 24. We have a remainder of 24 here, which means negative 1 is not a 0 of the polynomial function. So let's try positive 1. Bring the 1 down again, multiply by positive 1 this time, that's 1, add, multiply by positive 1, that's negative 2, add, multiply by positive 1, and add. Now this is good news, because our remainder is 0, positive 1 is a 0 of the function. But because it's a cubic, we're still looking for two more zeros. But we can use this 0 to help us write the polynomial in factored form. We now know that f of x is equal to, well, if 1 is a 0, x minus 1 must be a factor. And because we perform synthetic division, we know that the other factor would have to be this degree 2 polynomial, which would be 1x squared minus 2x minus 15. This is the reason why performing synthetic division is a nice way to determine these zeros, because if the remainder is 0, it gives us two factors of the polynomial function. And now, we can try to factor this. If it doesn't factor, we'd have to use the quadratic formula. Again, we're trying to find the x values that make this equal to 0. So we'd have x minus 1, this does factor. The factors of negative 15 that add the negative 2, that would be negative 5 and positive 3. So if we're looking for the values of x that make this equal to 0, again, we already found x equals 1 as a 0. Here we have x equals 5 as a 0. And here we have x equals negative 3 as a 0. Notice how these three x values would be the zeros that we're looking for. So we have positive 1, positive 5, and negative 3, which are the exact same zeros we found graphically very easily. So I'm sure you agree, if you had a choice, being able to graph the function is extremely helpful. It can save quite a bit of time. But if we're not able to graph the function, we would have to use this method here. We'll take a look at several more examples in the next few videos. Many of them will use a combination of using the graph as well as the method we used here. I hope you found this helpful.